Good morning, everyone. My name is Alexis Garati. I am the head of economic research of Euler MS. This is my pleasure to be with you today for this sustainability virtual week of The Economist. Let's start ESG risks abound in the insurance space. Let's have a look at the first slide. They have seen tremendous adoption since the United Nations introduced the principles for responsible investing in 2006. We are confident that in line with a quality approach investment, ESG full consistency mirrors better governance and better mitigation against social and environmental risks, altogether playing in favor of structurally lower risk and higher value proposition. ESG screening can assist in risk avoidance, especially since good ESG performance is positively correlated with higher credit rating. We conducted a global supply chain survey to understand how companies coped with the disruption of supply chain during the COVID outbreak. The results have reiterated resilience amid uncertainty in companies with strong sustainability profile. 32% of the respondents reported that they increased ESG due diligence on suppliers to mitigate the disruption in supply chains. Effective governance ensures that sustainability does not remain an abstract aspect of corporate strategy and enables companies to create long-term value by locking sustainable growth and building resilient business models. Concretely, higher quality governance leads to decreased credit risk because of information asymmetry reduction, higher accountability and higher transparency, leading to a positive value proposition. Let's switch to the following slide. The aim of our action consists of being a leader when integrating ESG into risk analysis. In January 2020, our company became the first credit insurer to include ESG risks in country ratings. We have also raised the ESG consideration to the Group Risk Credit Committee. Our imminent priority will become to remain the leaders of economic research when it comes to integrating ESG data in the risk models across large exposure. Our department's contribution to the ESG strategy is to augment the country and sector ratings with a set of ESG-related indicators. For the country risk rating, we included 6 indicators assessing the environmental sustainability. This includes, amongst others, energy use and CO2 emissions per GDP, renewable electricity output, and climate change vulnerability. Our team has also designed a social risk index to identify which countries are particularly vulnerable to systemic social risk, including events such as anti-government protests and other incidents that could become game changers for politics and policy making, as well as business and investment decisions. Going forward, our objective is to integrate ESG factors in our sector risk framework. We want to verify the consistency of these scores with qualitative assessments from our local business units, and estimate the potential impact of ESG factors on the average probability of defaulting by sector and country with the help from the credit intelligence team. Fundamentally, our aim is to help companies and investors clearly identify reliable and non-viable business models. Let's have a look at the following slide. Adopting exemplary standards of ESG in our product is very important. At Euler MS, we are proud to set the exemplary standards for trade finance and reinforce the alignment with Allianz's ambitious ESG agenda. We have rapidly grasped the importance of embedding ESG in the company's DNA. To this end, we have adapted our offer accordingly to accompany our clients' transition towards a more sustainable business model. We are supporting the transition to a low carbon economy through our product, Green to Green Single Risk, to tackle climate change. As of today, the economy still needs Euro 6.3 trillion of yearly investment to meet the Paris Climate Agreement's goals. And this product is our contribution to ensure the green investment goes in the right direction. At the level of the transactional covered unit, the product offers a virtuous green cycle that ensures all premium are invested in green bonds and private equity funds. In addition, we are keen to develop next generation companies by enhancing the in-house ESG knowledge to empower internal expertise. This enables us to engage with our clients on the strategic ESG risks and opportunities and provide transparent responses to their queries on our ESG commitment. To do so, we are upskilling our employees through dedicated trainings and onboarding, which are already available to our HR platform. Let's have a look to the last slide, which is dedicated to looking at the influence of ESG in underwriting policy. We value integrating ESG risks in our underwriting strategy, and we see in the assessment of the buyer's creditworthiness opportunities to mitigate against physical transition and liability risk. We believe that the existing and forthcoming ESG risks can have an impact on our core activities and those of our clients. Let me take the example of stranded assets in the energy sector to illustrate the transition risk. We conducted a study to estimate the future loss of value from stranded assets, and the results have shown that this loss could range from $0.3 trillion to $1.6 trillion. Coal assets alone could lose value in the order of $550 billion to the horizon of 2035. At Euler-Hermes, we apply different ESG due diligence at our counterparts, the insured clients and their clients. The ESG assessment of the insured clients, what we call commercial underwriting, is completed through an ESG referral system to assess the reputational risks of the transaction. For us, systemic unmitigated ESG risks would result in a deal day now, whereas the buyer ESG assessment process, what we refer to us as credit risk, is done through a two-threshold model system to assess the material implication of ESG risks in the full assessment of the company. Again, these are designed based on different ESG dimensions, first in the analyst assessment and then in escalating the case to the ESG office, for us to have a holistic view on the level of company's risk. As a conclusion, I would say that quality growth will be key in the future. In today's world, post-COVID-19 shock, over-indebtedness of the public and private sector is a looming priority. As such, sustainability of this debt will not depend on the quantity, but rather on the quality of growth that both public and private actors will be able to generate to ensure a sustainable transition. We believe that credit insurers have a key role to play in reactivating a new type of growth cycle, to be fundamentally characterized by both its sustainability and quality. Thank you very much for your attention.